Thanks, everyone, for arriving. A little housekeeping before we start. As you know, this is a meeting, and I have six other members of my council, so most of them will be in the other room outside listening to this, so it's not that they don't care. They just can't all come in this room and participate at once, so they may come in and out. So I'm going to turn this over to Supervisor Jane Parker.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor, and I want to thank everyone for being here and being willing to participate in this conversation. The purpose of this meeting is to allow you to get some information about what the county is thinking about, all the different things that we're weighing in terms of the possibility of acquiring the old Capital One site on Schilling Place. And I think I want to thank the staff from the Resources Management Agency, Benny Young and Robert Murdoch, for being here today. I understand that the work that the county has done on the due diligence, that when it's in paper form looks like this, is available on the county website now. So if you go on the county homepage, there will be an announcement that it's available, and you can click on that, and it will take you to this lovely report. And you will be hearing some of what's in it today, so you'll have a head start. So we're going to be, the county staff is going to be providing some information, and we also are lucky to and fortunate to have the participation of the city of Salinas. The county partners with the city on a number of issues, and of course the issue of the civic center, the government center, the downtown is something that we have been discussing, and we have various agreements about, and will continue to be working on those issues. So I appreciate Mayor Gunter and City Manager Ray Corpus for being here and also being part of the program. But as equally as important is giving me an opportunity to hear from you prior to our final decision next week. So it's really important that, for me, that I hear what people are thinking and talking about. So I will hand this over to the mayor to go over the agenda and how that's going to work. Take it away.
Thank you, Supervisor. So everybody knows we're being broadcast live on Channel 25. We went on the air at 4 o'clock. First portion of it will be a presentation from Benny Young and Bob Murdoch from the County RMA and David Sparr, the County Economic Development. They will explain their project, what they've been working on, and then we will go to a presentation by Ray Corpus as far as what the city's been doing in regards to this. Then we're going to open it up to a question and answer period, and there's going to be some 3x5 cards that they're going to be available for people that just want to ask some general questions. And then we're going to go to for public comment, where that'll be an opportunity for the people from Seoul. I understand there's a couple of presenters here, one that talks about traffic, one talks about economic development. I believe Mr. Farmer, probably he'll need more than one 3x5 card, but we'll let him go ahead and talk, and some other folks. And then somewhere down the road, we'll have closing comments. We're going to try to end this by 6 o'clock. So ask everybody to be a little respectful of time. We haven't determined the amount. When we get down to public comment, we'll see how many talkers there are, and then we'll determine how much time is available. So I'd like to turn it over to the Monterey County presentation from Benny Young and Bob Murdoch in the County RMA, David Sparr, County Economic Development.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor, Supervisor Parker, Mr. Corpus, members of the audience. My name is Benny Young. I'm with the Resource Management Agency for Monterey County. And I want to echo what Supervisor Parker indicated to you. The material related to the county's due diligence is now available online. If you go to the county's website, the web portal, there will be a link that you can click on that will take you to the Resource Management Agency website. And the full due diligence report is now available online. The due diligence report itself is not that thick. However, there are 15 attachments, and that's why the final report, when you make a hard copy of it, is about 6 inches thick. I would also mention that we do not have copies of the PowerPoint that I'm going to walk through shortly available today. However, that is also going to be online and is online presently, so that you would be able to get a copy of the PowerPoint, because we'll move kind of quickly through the PowerPoint. We have about 25 slides, so I need to cover 2 slides per minute to stay within the allotted time. And with that said, I'm going to launch. First of all, we thought it might be good to just provide a context with regard to Monterey County's property management in the Salinas vicinity. Countywide, the county owns about 2 million square feet of property. We lease over 500,000 square feet. The annual leasing cost is about $9 million. In the Salinas area alone, and this is a subset of the previous numbers, there's about 1.8 million square feet of owned space that the county has. There's about 400,000, a little over 400,000 of lease space, and the annual leasing costs are a little over $7 million. Schilling Place, if the county were to move ahead with acquisition, would be not quite 300,000 square feet, so you can see that it would be a substantial component of the county's own space in Salinas as well as countywide. The second slide, I know you can't read it, is simply there for illustrative purposes. It indicates the distribution of county leases in the Salinas area, and as you can see, we have quite a few leases in Salinas, over 20, and they're dispersed around the community. And that's one of the reasons we felt that it was worthwhile at least looking at the possibility of acquiring the Schilling Place property.
Would you just point out the government center and the Schilling Place that's in a different color so people place it on the map?
Thank you, Supervisor Parker. Downtown is the kind of the blue rectangle on the left side of that photo or that picture. And then Schilling Place would be on the southeast extremity of, thank you, Bob, of the area. Some of the facility needs that we're dealing with presently in Salinas have to do with a substantial component of our downtown operations being housed in modular office facilities. Some of the court-related functions like the district attorney and the public defender, as well as human resources training and our law library, are located in modular facilities. And we would like to get the DA and the defender out of those modular facilities sooner than later, if possible. Looking at the possibility of acquiring the Schilling Place facility would allow us to do that sooner than later, potentially. We also have inadequate parking at the county government center, as many of you know. The county employee parking is poorly located. The court needs more courtrooms. We presently are planning for the construction of additional jail housing, not downtown, but also within the city of Salinas, and a new juvenile hall, also inside the city of Salinas. This past spring, in April, our board adopted a 5-year capital improvement program for major county facilities investment. We call it the 404 fund plan. 404 fund is simply the nomenclature that we use to designate the fund that our capital facilities are financed out of. That represents a $198 million investment countywide over the next 5 years, and $196 million would be in the Salinas area. And you can see the listing of the facilities that would be built within the next 5 years in Salinas: jail housing, new juvenile hall, renovation of the east-west wing, a building for the public defender. We are a participant in the Salinas Vibrancy Plan. We just recently renovated 20 East LaSalle and moved our probation department into that facility. We're remediating 312 East LaSalle. That's the old county road yard, and we're talking to the city of Salinas about a possible trade of equity so that the city could locate a new police station at that location. I'm sure Mr. Corpus will tell you more about that. We're studying the old jail for possible reuse, and we're planning for a city, county, possibly state as well, parking facility that would take some of the pressure off the inadequate parking facilities in downtown at the present. That plan calls for about $48 million in borrowing or financing. The county uses certificates of participation. That's a debt instrument that's typically retired over 30 years. So why Schilling Place? The property is potentially available at a greatly reduced price. It could potentially be a less expensive option to funding our existing 404 plan. In fact, we will get to this in a minute. Our preliminary projections, based on a very conservative cost analysis, is that this represents, if we were to move forward, a savings of over $20 million present-day value over the next 30 years for the County of Monterey. The analysis we've done is very conservative, and so it could be substantially more than that. There's a possibility of creating a one-stop permit center at that location. It's a LEED Gold facility, and that would help meet our AB 32 goals, greenhouse gas reduction, by replacing that less efficient facilities at that location. It would result in improved parking not only here in the government center area for county employees and potentially help with city and courts overflow as well, but improved parking at the Schilling Place facility, which has about 1,200 parking spaces. It would allow us to consolidate record storage. We presently have three major record storage facilities in lease space in Salinas. We would consolidate that at Schilling Place. The Schilling Place facility has three components. There's about a 200,000 square foot office or administrative space. There's a not quite 90,000 square foot warehouse, which would become the location for consolidated record storage. And then there's a 4,500 square foot facility that was used for childcare, and we'll talk about that in a little bit. It allows us to potentially move operations out of modular offices sooner than later. The county would own rather than rent the space. The removal of the modulars would provide for on-site surface parking in the near term and potentially give us a location for a joint or even three-way, if the state chooses to participate, parking facility for city, county, and state employees on that location. The east-west wing, if we don't have to rehab it, the 404 plan that I described presently anticipates rehabilitating the east-west wing for administrative occupancy for about $36 million, and that's kind of a high price to pay for administrative office space. A lot of it's due to the fact that it's a historic structure and would have to be entirely repurposed. If we were to do Schilling, we might not have to do that. And then we could potentially make that available to the state if they're interested for court space. We do know that the state needs more court space in downtown Salinas and in the county. It facilitates continuity of operations for the county in the event of disaster. There are admittedly many challenges associated with this possible acquisition, and we've tried to deal with what we've heard at a public forum that the county had early on where we listened to many of you, and we have had a comment line, and we're listening to the comments and taking those and trying to address those as best we can through the due diligence period. Site access is one of the key issues. Organizational change, both that's largely an internal one to the county, because we need to make sure that the functions that we would locate at Schilling, if we complete the transaction, that it would work for them. It potentially has an economic impact on the commercial real estate market in Salinas, and we've heard a lot of concern about possible lost economic opportunity if the county were to purchase the Schilling Place facility. We've been involved in a due diligence period for about 75 days now. That due diligence period ends at the end of August. We're asking our board to make a decision on August 26th, the week from Tuesday. Normally, the material that we're reviewing with you this afternoon and is available now online wouldn't be made available until this coming Friday. However, we knew that many of you were interested in seeing it sooner than that and have an opportunity to look at that and analyze it from your own perspective. And so that's one reason we've gone ahead and made it available sooner than later. During that 75 days, we've negotiated a final purchase price with the owner. We've negotiated a buyout of a lease with Capital One. Capital One still has over 5 years of lease obligation left with the owners, and they're willing to buy that out. So that would become part of the purchase. We did a property appraisal, a facility assessment, a financial analysis, and a traffic impact analysis. And you can see all of those documents online if you go to the link that we've mentioned. We've said right from the start that this purchase, if it's to proceed, must make financial sense for the county in operational sense, business sense. It must meet county space needs, the ones that we're trying to deal with the current 404 capital improvement plan. It needs to save taxpayer funds over time, and we need to make certain that it will provide us a way to improve our services over time and maintain good service to our clients and citizens of Monterey County. The property was purchased by Capital One in 2008, for $63 million. The negotiated purchase price is $36 million. The Capital One lease buyout is $23 million, so the net cost to the county is $13 million. And that purchase includes a lot of furnishings and equipment, such as forklifts and the warehouse and that sort of thing. We did an appraisal. Sorry for the misspelling. It's an appraisal, not an appaisal. But there are three approaches to value typically for commercial real estate transactions. The first is a reproduction cost new less depreciation approach. What would it take to build the kind of facility we need new and depreciate it to the present time? That's $56 million. That's the value of that facility. There's a fair market rental value approach, an income stream approach to value, and our appraiser believes the income stream approach supports a $39 million value for the facility. There's a fair market value. That means what would willing buyers pay for this, regardless of the income stream or the replacement value, and that's estimated to be $37 million. We need to read the fine print on that. The lease buyout is worth $27 million, and the land and buildings, because there's not a particular market in Salinas for big administrative office space right at the present time, or at least that's the opinion of our appraiser. The land and buildings have a value of somewhere between 8.75 and 12.5 million for a total of 37 million at the present time. We did a very complete assessment of the facility because we wanted, if the county taxpayers are going to make this investment, we want to make sure we know what we're getting into. Generally speaking, the facility is in very good condition. There are no substantial issues. There are about $2.8 million of deferred maintenance needs that we would need to find a way to make sure we include over time if we move forward with the purchase. And the financial analysis that we've done includes that. We did an estimate of what it would take to move into the facility and repurpose it for county administrative uses and warehouse uses. And you can see the total cost for that is about $16 million. I would indicate again, as I did earlier, that these are very conservative analyses. I think it's important for us as staff to relay information to the board that we can over-deliver on, and I honestly believe that we'll be able to repurpose the facility for far less than $16 million. But we've done our financial analysis on that basis because, sometimes costs do escalate, and we wanted to make sure that we had allowance for cost escalation and contingency and other costs such as permitting and cabling and that sort of thing if the county were to repurpose the facility for county administrative uses. One of the keys to making it work for us is to find a place for the district attorney, get him out of those modules sooner than later, and so the premise is that he would move into the second floor of the government center in downtown Salinas. That's presently where the Resource Management Agency is housed, for those of you who are familiar with the government center. And we've done a preliminary layout to show the district attorney how that it would satisfactorily house his operations. And we've included a $4 million cost to repurpose that second floor for the district attorney. The only people that would leave the government center are the people presently on the second floor right now. That's 141 people. And you'll see later that we've estimated about 147 might leave downtown Salinas to go to Schilling Place because we would also relocate our training function to that location. The total cost to move in is represented on this slide. It's the $2.8 million in deferred maintenance, $4 million to repurpose the government center for the district attorney, $16 million for improvements at Schilling Place for a total cost of not quite $23 million. Again, that's a very conservative estimate, but it's the basis for the financial analysis that we've done for the board and which we will summarize for you next. The current 404, we looked at four scenarios. The current 404 plan, which I mentioned earlier, was adopted by the board this spring, is the first scenario. The second scenario is Schilling Place plus just the district attorney. The third scenario, which is a better comparison to the 404 plan, would be Schilling Place plus the district attorney plus the public defender plus joint parking structure facility with the city of Salinas. And the final scenario that we evaluated was what would it take for us to lease space to accommodate these uses. So those four scenarios have been analyzed from a financial perspective using a 30-year cost obligation and discounting that to the present, to a present value for each one. And that's reflected on the next evaluation, we did an evaluation matrix to see kind of qualitatively which of the four scenarios would work best for the county. And as you can see, the third scenario that involves Schilling, the district attorney, the public defender, and parking space is the only one that met all of our objectives. I know we're throwing a lot at you in a hurry, and my apologies for that, but this information will be available online, and you can look at it in depth if you like. The summary of the cost analysis is on this slide. If you look to the right-hand column, you'll see that the current 404 plan, that's the one that we're presently operating on, that would include total rehabilitation of the east-west wing of the courts, for example. The present value of that, that cost obligation is estimated to be $85 million. So go to the third line on the right-hand side. You see a $64 million figure. That's comparable to the 404 plan. And so that's where the estimated $20 million present value cost savings to the county taxpayers comes in. $64 million versus $85 million is about $21 million in present value savings for the county over the next 30 years. The leasing alternative is more expensive than the third alternative. And the Schilling plus DA alternative or scenario doesn't really work for us because it doesn't include the joint parking facility and taking care of the public defender, even though we analyzed it. There are potential concerns, obviously, associated with this. From a county perspective, it requires cash for debt service and operating expenses beginning in year one, which would be next July, July 1st, 2015. And that may mean that we have to redirect some of our county resources to make sure that we could police that debt and that obligation if the board decides to move ahead. That we've encountered, as you know, internal and external resistance to the very notion that we would look at this, and so we need to deal with that respectfully. It would relocate 147 employees currently at the government center to the Schilling Place facility. It would potentially reduce property tax revenue, and we have taken that into account in the financial analysis. So we've estimated the full value of the tax collections and made that an added cost for acquiring the Schilling Place facility because we know that that's a community concern that's been articulated. There's a perception of less convenient public access and a possibility of a lost economic opportunity for the city if there were to be a major employer, for example, that would be interested in that facility. Preliminary occupancy is outlined on this slide. It's the resource management agency. On the left-hand side is the administrative office facility. On the right-hand side is the warehouse. The resource management agency, the water resources agency, the health department's call center, and some functions that do not require intensive customer access, HR learning and organizational development, elections, which is currently in lease space on the south end of Salinas and overcrowded. Information technology could be centralized at this location, and our grand jury would potentially move over from Marina. In the warehouse, we would consolidate our records retention. We would put our furniture surplus under contracts purchasing. Our Department of Social Services records function would move in. The health department's records function would move into that location. The social service facility on on South Main would not move because it's too intensively customer oriented to fit into a location like Schilling. We've tried to stay away from direct customer access functions at Schilling Place if we move ahead. It does have an impact to the community. The number of jobs will increase somewhat because we would move some functions over, like the grand jury, from Marina. And some of the district attorney's units in Marina would move to the government center. There are approximately 850 city and county and court employees in downtown presently, and 147 of those would go to Schilling Place. That's about 17% of the county and court's downtown employment. We're hopeful that the Taylor Farms facility would help soften the impact of the 147 employees moving to another part of Salinas. We're almost done. Thank you for your indulgence. We want to talk just a little bit before we conclude about traffic, because that's a key issue, and I would like to ask Bob Murdoch to talk briefly about traffic impacts.
Thank you. Good evening. We did hear a great deal of concern about access to and from the site. So as part of our analysis, we did do a traffic impact analysis. We studied five intersections. In addition, we did a travel time study and how long it took to get to and from this site and back and forth between this site and the government center. So with respect to the traffic analysis, we studied five intersections. And this is a synopsis of what you'll see in the due diligence report. Now, when we first contracted for the traffic impact report, we didn't know what the occupancy would be. We assumed a standard trip generation rate for this type of facility, and based on the square footage, it actually equates to an occupancy of 700. Since the occupancy is 400, this really overestimates the impact, but this is what's in the report, so I'd just like to keep remind everybody that, again, it's based on an occupancy of 700 versus 400. So on Abbott and Harkins, there's no impact. On Abbott and Sanborn, there's no impact. At Harkins and Hanson, which is really the entrance to and from the site, there currently the AM peak hour level of service is C, and it will remain C. The peak hour level of service will decrease from D to F. At Airport and Hanson, which is unsignalized, it's an AM peak hour level of service will remain A. The PM peak hour will decrease from B to D. And the biggest impact really is the northbound. This is really associated with in the evening when everybody goes home. The northbound PM peak hour LOS will decrease from E to F. And at Airport and Turvin, the AM peak hour remains E, although it decreases slightly, and the PM peak hour remains D, although again it decreases slightly. Now, the travel time and parking. We ended up trying to time what it would take to get back and forth between Schilling Place and the government center. We heard a lot of concern about if you have staff at the Schilling Place, they're going to have to spend a lot of time going back and forth. We did a number of time studies, took different routes, and the worst case scenario is during the PM peak, it took 10 and a half minutes to get from Schilling Place to the government center. We also did a number of travel time study as to how long would it take to get to either the government center or Schilling Place, say from the Monterey Peninsula, and northbound 101 and southbound 101. Essentially, it's equivalent. It's just about the same amount of time to get to either facility. Parking, government center has 407 spaces, Schilling Place has 1,175, so significantly more parking spaces. So essentially, it's the time to reach each facility is about the same, the congestion you'll see is about the same, but the delays you'll experience finding a parking space at Schilling Place is greatly reduced. So as a conclusion, the traffic analysis, county staff and the public will experience about the same level of congestion, whether going to each facility, but Schilling provides adequate parking for everyone, and currently the government center does not.
Moving forward, we've asked the board to make a decision on August 26th, and the draft staff report and the final due diligence study are available online now through the county's website. Go to the web portal and you'll see a link you can click on that'll take you to the information that we have just summarized for you very quickly. If the board approves the purchase on August 26th, there will be a 30-day escrow period which would close at the end of September, and the county would own the building at the end of September. If the board does not decide to approve the purchase and sale agreement on August 26th, the process will end and the county will get back the $100,000 deposit that we've posted as part of the due diligence process. And with that, Mr. Mayor and Supervisor Parker, that concludes the RMA staff report. And thank you so much for your indulgence as we've gone through a lot of information in a hurry. Thank you.
Thank you. Now we're going to hear from the city manager, Ray Corpus. As you know, we've done a little bit of work on with the county on numerous projects, and we're going to lay down some of the items that we have talked about, having heard from the county when we learned that they were moving. We heard this through one of our gentlemen that we have been doing business with. So our first opportunity came almost as well as it did to some of the public. So we sent them a letter and indicated we'd like to meet with them and talk with them. So, and we've been meeting with them on different occasions. Now the city manager will tell you what we've been doing and what's going on. I'll turn it over to the city manager.
Thank you, Mayor Gunther and Supervisor Parker, Benny and Bob and David, thank you. We wanted to cover first some projects and initiatives the city has embarked on prior to Shilling Place, prior to the Cap 1 discussion. And many of these have occurred over the last few years. So when people say, what is the city doing, or what has the city done, there's at least 12 projects we've identified that we've spent a huge amount of resource time and a huge amount of dollars in trying to support the renewal of downtown. So I'll go through that first page. Maybe you can go to the next slide. Liz, you can help me. Okay. So many of you have heard about the vibrancy plan. That started about 10 months ago. It's really to take a new look at how our downtown can be renewed. With the implementation as well as just the planning, we're looking at improving parking, we're looking at traffic flow, how could that be better, and then we're looking at amenities downtown. And surprisingly, we've had at least 26 stakeholders regularly at these meetings, either monthly or even more often, to look at how this plan might work. We just finished with the parking element. So again, this is a three-part support plan in that the city initiated it, the county is participating with us, and they continue to participate with us and the private sector. So this plan is in excess of $300,000 right now in terms of the effort that's going on. The government center is a memorandum of understanding, which was, I think, initiated in May of 2012 to look at really a downtown government center in Salinas. So this includes both the planning and implementation. So almost on a monthly basis, the city and county key staff have been meeting to look at a government center, proposals, different uses of land, different ways that we can support the development and renewal of downtown. So this is a major undertaking. As you know, both the city and the county own lots of different property in and around the greater downtown of Salinas. We also, as part of the vibrancy plan and the government center emphasis, started a business or a property business improvement district. Some of you know that we have an existing business improvement district through the Old Town Business Association. But we thought it was important for property owners to be part of the process in terms of renewal of downtown. Take ownership, step up to the table, make some improvements, decide on how you want to make downtown better for all of us. So that's underway. We've initiated that initial formation is about $80,000 in the city, and the city has started that process, and I think it's going fairly well. We've had an initial formation meeting. That would include the city as a property owner, and it also would include, we'd hope, the county as a property owner in the greater downtown. We think this is an excellent tool. It's been used in San Francisco, San Jose, San Diego, Los Angeles as a way of improving business districts and sort of the main street of revitalization in many of those cities. The Steinbeck Innovation Center is a offshoot of the Steinbeck Innovation Cluster. The center would be located downtown. They haven't announced their final plans, but we understand that they will be in a building downtown, and that announcement should be made in the next few months. And that's a major project because that project will have entrepreneurial efforts to increase and focus startups and hopefully major businesses in the field of agriculture, technology, and innovation, which is a major economic initiative for the city and for the growers and farmers in our community. The Taylor Building was mentioned, headquarters, next slide. That brings up to, I think, we think up to 250-plus employees to downtown. That, we think, is also spurring additional interest from the commercial sector in terms of more private businesses looking at downtown as a headquarter facility, or at least a regional facility. So there's been inquiries. As the market improves, we expect more inquiries and more actual, I think, trading of properties and hopefully some new businesses that would be part of that mix. The LaSalle Market Project is a mixed-use development project. It's been on for like 6 years. It would connect an important part of our city with downtown and connect downtown with an important part of our city, East Salinas. This is a major project. It was referred to before. There are two parts to this process or project that are requirements for the city. One is to establish a community safety center or new police building in the LaSalle, as well as move the transfer station that the Salinas Valley Solid Waste Authority has. And both those are being worked on. In fact, it was mentioned in the county's presentation, 312 LaSalle is the property we're looking at for the police station. We're spending $250,000 to do the schematic design, which would show us how the facility would be laid out in terms of the needs of the police department and the different programs they have. In addition to that, we also met with the Salinas Valley Solid Waste Authority to convince them that moving the transfer station, the preferred site would be Madison Lane and not Work Street, to make sure that, you know, that site's already permitted for that type of activity, and we think a partnership could be worked out with the city, the county, the authority, and private businesses, property owners, to put the road in that would be necessary to make use of that facility out at Madison Lane. They would move the transfer station outside the city. I think that would be a great benefit for all of us. Chinatown revitalization, I mentioned a 4090 affordable housing unit, which is being proposed by MedPen Housing, and also the preservation of the historic structures. We do have a master plan that we are bringing to the council. We've also bought one property at 10 Soledad Street to refurbish, to make use of as a potential anchor in terms of stabilizing that community and revitalizing it. We're also working with the property owner of what was formerly the Copa Cabana to transform that facility into what is a warming shelter for the homeless. And that would have showers and other public facilities. So that's being worked on. We're working on the lease with that. Chinatown's important. It's just on the northeast side of the outskirts of downtown, but you can actually, as the mayor would say, you can actually throw a rock and hit it from downtown. So it's an important part of development and the sort of the shoring up, if you will, of the economics of the area. The Intermodal Transportation Center is something we've been working on for many years, maybe 14 or 15 now. It looks like it will happen in terms of the Salinas rail connection to Silicon Valley in 2018. That's a $46 million project. TAMC is the lead agency, but we're also going to do transportation-oriented development right there. There'll be mixed-use planned at that site. So as visitors come and they can take advantage of some of the amenities that would be part of that transit-oriented development, including housing that would be part of that process, as well as for the development of that portion of the greater downtown. Old Town Salinas Association has been an important part of, you know, building the character and building the sort of the platform of merchant and retail and other types of business, related businesses in downtown, the old downtown, and we have supported the Old Town Association over the years. In addition to the assessments they receive, we've supported in the tune of either $50,000, and we currently now support them in excess of, I believe, $30,000 a year for additional security and special events in downtown. We have been involved as a third party, the third party in the California State University at Monterey Bay, discussions with the National Steinbeck Center so that the university can move to the Steinbeck Center and be a major asset for downtown. We're supporting that. We're working with both. We think both can occupy the building at One Main, and that was something that the council and the administration certainly has been working on for the last few months, and hopefully something will work out in the next few days. The Gateway Senior Apartments was completed last year. That was a $20+ million project. The city spent close to almost $5 million. That's 50 units of affordable senior housing. We think the heart and soul of any downtown revitalization has to be housing, and that's part of the housing mix that will happen over the next few years. How come Benny didn't have a time limit? That's why he was speaking up so loud. Okay. So, and then in addition to the senior apartments, you may recall about 10 years we had the La Plaza Grande, which was 90 affordable units, and that was at, I believe, at the Salinas Street and Market. So we made some investments in housing to shore up the downtown. We also approved the council approved the economic development element, which is a first step in making that part of the change or element to the general land use plan of the city, sort of pioneering effort. But the first full 5 years are going to be focused on infill, including downtown. So that's why the plan is so important. Next slide. You can see this is sort of the greater downtown. The red property is, those properties in red are the cities. The property in green are the counties. There's some redevelopment, former redevelopment property that is up in the northeast corner. And then there's Roosevelt School. But this is a conceptual drawing of what a greater downtown could look like. And as we talk about it, I'm sure the PBID, or the Property Business Improvement District, people are also formulating a boundary. But we think the greater downtown should include the Intermodal Transit Center. It should include the county and the city government center. So that's the background. And with that background, we now have Schilling Place. I think you've heard the characteristics of what that property or that complex offers. We have met with the county staff specifically on this issue for the, I think we've had 4+ meetings and had lots of phone calls and discussions. So this is a high level proposal on what we think might happen to fully utilize the properties we have in the city, we own as a city government, and those properties that are fully owned by the county. So, next slide. So this is a overview of map, if you will. The light property indicates the property that the city specifically owns. The blue, and including the white property, designated property, is the county administration building, but the blue is all county. MST is up there in the far right-hand corner. And you can see some green properties that we have also talked about that are potential property developments that could occur as part of the overall government center complex. So there are, as you can see, there's lots of property, and much of it is being underutilized in the way of parking, right? Those lots can be fully utilized, more intensively utilized, to have commercial, retail, county offices, other government uses. We've talked about parking lot 12, which is at Gabalon and Lincoln. That's the city parking lot right across the way here, right across the street. It's about 41,000 square feet. We think that that could be a great property to jointly develop. We've been talked about if, in terms of timing, about how that could work for the district attorney for a new office space there with mixed use and some other government functions as possible, and including some additional parking. We've also mentioned parking lot 17, which is over on Allisal and Lincoln on the corner there. We own the last portion. Actually, we own the old site. We've leased most of the site where the public defender and the parking is to the county in exchange for some other commitments, but we're willing to part with the rest of it to look at a joint development of that whole parcel. So when we talk about development, we're not just talking about city parking lots or city property. We're talking about a joint effort by both the county and the city, as well as county property that's owned and could be utilized for higher best use. So that parking lot's currently used for city fleet, but it can be reordered in terms of what we could accomplish in lieu of moving to Schilling Place. There was a mention of a need for a joint county-city parking garage, and we would include the state. If the district attorney's offices are moved out of the modular, that site can be fully developed to house a large parking structure, which would take care of a large part of the need for the county and city employees, as well as the state, if they're willing to participate with the county in terms of the court space that's needed to be funded. So we think there's a joint participation agreement that's possible here. This is something that we have talked about before CAP 1 in terms of the major parking facility to address the parking needs in and around the government center. We think also the need to move out the resource management agency, we understand that, but we also feel that one of the possibilities here could be a joint location with our permanent center. The permanent center is over on 65 Allisaw, but there's some potential of additional space there. In the existing space, it's maybe not enough for the county, but we could look at other office space. We could also fully develop the parking lot that's adjacent to that building. Right now, we think immediately we can produce 13,500 square feet to start that process. So I think it would be a good idea for business, you know, to have that kind of joint operation with both the city and the county permitting functions co-located, sort of helpful for customer service. We also talked about doing some improvements for traffic signal and the busy street on West Allisaw, because many of the employees of the county have to cross the street, and it is a very busy street, so there's some improvements including signalization as well as some different treatments to the streets that need to happen, which would slow the traffic down, and so we're committed to that as well. There are a couple of county parking lots we think are underutilized that could be a prime development opportunity for both the city and county to undertake. Those include the parking lot at Gabalon and Capitol, which is right behind the administrative building. In fact, there had been talked at one time, and we could talk about that again, about a building, a twin to the existing county administration building, which is right there. So it could be a mixed-use twin, again, offering up more space for the county and developing actually more parking within that kind of a space. The other parking lot, which is important, is the Allisaw and Capitol. Look at it, Allisaw and Capitol. This is a larger parking area. This could be developed certainly up to four stories or more. Actually, I think four stories is our limit, but this could be office space as well as mixed use and additional parking. So there are parking lots that abound in the area that really could be looked at as part of the joint effort for a major government center here. And we've talked to Congressman Farr, and he's given a list of federal offices that might have a potential of locating or relocating to the government center. Lastly, in terms of what we've been offering, is we looked at the issue of farmlands, and the county has expressed some concerns about our recently adopted economic development element. So we would be willing to review and work with the county to change that as part of the solution in terms of their move for Schilling Place. We could look at taking much less in terms of the future growth of the city and and take less property that might be better used as agricultural land. But that's something that could be, we think, further developed along with the county. They have expressed concerns about the element. And in the context of this overall deal, we think it's worth at least pursuing as part of the overall structure. So this proposal looks at sort of the 20,000-foot level, but it's something that we think is doable. We think that infill and taking advantage of property that we already own that is part of the government center is a key to supporting downtown. So in summary, the city's proposed to the county several elements. We've offered additional office space. We've offered additional parking, both surface and possibly a new joint facility. We're talking about and interested in co-locating the resource management agency with the city permit center in some fashion. And we're also looking at joint development of our existing lands, whether they're parking lots or lands that are being occupied by other buildings right now for better uses, higher intense uses, which is part of sort of the infill strategy we have in making downtown a much better place to work, play, and live. So in summary, we'll continue to work on these projects that I mentioned earlier, those 12 projects that have helped move downtown towards a renewal stage. We'll also continue to work with our county, our government counterpart here, to our partners to provide additional options in lieu of moving to Schilling Place. So that's Mayor and Supervisor Parker is my presentation. Sorry I went over time, but I want to be sure I had equal billing with Benny.
Thank you. Appreciate that. Supervisor Parker, you have some questions that have been turned in.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. And yes, I do have some questions. And I want to encourage people, this is the opportunity, if you do have a question where you would like an answer, this is the time to write them on cards and get them to us. When we get to public comment, as you know, that allows you to speak, but there won't be the opportunity for any of the panel members to answer you. So let's see, we're starting this a little bit behind schedule, but essentially we'll try to go from now till about 5:15 or 5:20 to still allow sufficient time for public comment. So I've got a dozen-ish. I see more coming. There are several questions that I think this one captures reasonably well. Actually, there are two cards that I'll consolidate. One question is, did the due diligence study the alternative of committing to the government center MOU? And a little bit more detail, how does this proposal support the government center MOU? How will the county fulfill their promise to plan and implement the government center MOU?
Thank you for the question. The county would intend to still have a full presence in downtown Salinas, obviously. The government center would be fully occupied. We would not be abandoning downtown. We would continue to work with the city on the downtown vibrancy plan. We're already a financial partner in that. If you look at the county's track record, we have a history of investment in downtown Salinas. I see that continuing. This is not the Schilling Place alternative, as I mentioned earlier, is a component of the county's long-term facilities plan if we move ahead with it, but it does not signal an abandonment of downtown whatsoever. The truth is that we have to consider other issues as well in terms of the county's ability to move forward with long-term facility planning, not the least of which is the cost associated with that and the time that it takes to implement projects and the space that's available for that, and related to that, of course, is traffic and parking. We would continue to be committed to working with Ray Corpus and the mayor and the city of Salinas on downtown vitality, vibrancy and investment. This is not, the Schilling Place alternative, in my view, is not an abandonment of downtown whatsoever by the County of Monterey.
Thank you. A couple of related questions. One is related to the MOU. How much and how soon can the city of Salinas make their plan work? So I guess, in general, what's the timeline for some of the opportunities that the city has suggested to the county?
Well, I think, first of all, we mentioned specifically immediately we could co-locate some of the functions in the RMA, not all of them, but immediately some of them. Immediately means within the next month or so. So all the rest of them take some time in terms of actually developing an agreement, specific business terms with the county. So part of the build-out of our properties includes a commitment of resources, and I don't have that yet from the county. I do have general information that they will support the government center concept, the vibrancy plan, but we don't have the specifics in terms of the actual dates. So in some cases, we can make the parking lots available for more county parking. That might be a little bit of a task since we'd have to move some city employees, but there might be a possibility in co-locating and some of those efforts that, and better utilize some of the properties for the parking, because that's a major concern of the county.
Thank you. And while you're there talking about parking, I have a question. When the city presented the status of the vibrancy plan, parking was the third priority, and city staff couldn't say when parking would be addressed. Has the vibrancy plan been revised? You may have touched on that. And then also, while you're there, where can the city's proposal be found electronically?
The vibrancy plan can be found on our website. And in this last week, they did decide on the parking provisions. There's still some detail that needs to be worked out. So I think at least the direction and the specifics of the parking will be done. Now, the other element of the parking, which can't be done by the vibrancy plan committee or the stakeholders, would be a separate review of the parking rates that the city charges and the parking income and the attendant possibilities in that area, and that would be a separate study to be held later. But the parking element is still in place. We think by the end of this year, we'd have the vibrancy plan completed and signed off by the county, by the city, and the private sector.
Thank you. Question, two questions related to costs. How could the cost for the refurbishing at the courts be so high in light of the significant millions already spent? That's actually a very separate question from the other one. So I guess I'll let you. It's.
Oh, very well. We think the question has to do with the cost of rehabilitating the east-west wing, which is presently vacant. That's the old county courthouse. The current 404 plan envisions that would be rehabilitated and utilized for administrative office space to house the district attorney, and the estimated cost of that's about $36 million. Why so much? It's a historic structure, and it would have to be completely rehabilitated and repurposed to utilize for administrative office uses. It has courtrooms in existence within the facility, so it's a dramatic departure from the original intent and utilization of the structure, and that plus seismic and environmental issues has to do with providing, and that maybe that helps explain why it costs $36 million to do that project. That's our current estimate.
Thank you. While we're talking about the east-west wing, how much total space or square footage, I guess, is available between the old east-west building and the old jail. I don't know how much the old jail is going to help us, but...
Sure. The east-west wing has a gross square footage of 70,000 square feet, although it's, the way it was constructed, it's rather inefficient, but 70,000 is the gross square footage. The old jail is about 20,000 square feet, but again, it would, we're right in the middle of doing a reuse study, and one of the challenges we're having with both structures is seismic issues and contamination due to asbestos and lead paint. So that's why it's very expensive to rehab both of those.
Thank you. A question on economic impact. What analysis has the county done on the overall economic impact of this plan beyond just the purported cost savings to the county? And then some detail, what will be the community-wide impact of this move on jobs, tax proceeds, and economic development?
Thanks for that question, too. During the due diligence period, we did not complete an overall economic impact analysis from the standpoint of the community at large. The due diligence work that the county did was primarily focused on the business operational aspects of the possible purchase from a county perspective and making sure that it works financially for the county taxpayers as a whole. We didn't have time or resources to commission or conduct an overall economic impact study related to the possible acquisition.
Thank you. And I guess, Dave Spahr, do you want to say anything about any of the economic impact? I'm going to ask Mr. Corpus if he has any thoughts. But
thank you, Dave Spahr. What we looked at is the ability to attract other companies there and replace the jobs that were lost. You've got 1,200 parking spaces, so it's about 1,100 jobs. We lost 850 with HSBC, the Capital One. The difficulty is the state legislature has passed 8-hour overtime laws that has made it unattractive for call centers and back office operations. So looking at a similar user for that building, been unsuccessful in attracting anybody. So when you look at the loss economic impact, it actually becomes a white elephant. And so it's a reuse of that. I think it could serve the community best if a government entity took that building off the market and we made other buildings with free space available for the private sector because they'd be easier to absorb. This is similar to the building that's in Scotts Valley known as Borland Software and is still vacant today. They've leased up 60,000 square feet out of 300,000 square feet.
Thank you. And while you're at the microphone, one of the specific areas that this person wanted to understand was what would be, if the county moved to the Schilling Place buildings, what would be the impact on jobs in the area? Do you have a pithy response to that?
You know, hard to tell on what the impact would be out at Schilling Place. So far, it's only 145 jobs, so it's a very little or minimal impact whatsoever. Downtown, there's no impact because you're going to replace those jobs with another employer coming in to fill the Taylor Farms building. So it's just a shift. Our goal is to eventually, over time, consolidate buildings outside of Salinas proper and move those employees in. So we will continue to grow, continue to expand over the next 20 years, and we think overall it'll be a positive impact.
Yes, Mr. Young?
Supervisor, there's a small positive impact associated with the acquisition. There would be over 30 jobs that would move into this area from other locations like Marina that we would then have the space to accommodate. I realize it's not a substantial amount, but there is a small impact, positive impact on job movement into Salinas associated with the transaction.
Thank you. Mr. Corpus.
Yes, thank you. We, when it was announced that Capital One was selling the building or moving out of town, that day we started on working on the economic development activities in terms of dealing with that major dislocation, economic dislocation. We had been sending site selectors there to that property. I have, and my team have been talking to private developers. The opportunity lost is that a private entity would bring new facility, new jobs to this area, because the Schilling place is a unique opportunity for the private sector. There isn't another building or campus that size that offers this type of space. And so there was interest, there have been interests. I talked to two developers that were in the bidding process with the county and trying to help them locate agriculture, technology, and innovation businesses, as well as agriculture-related businesses. So the city was intimately involved in the opportunity of new jobs at that site. Now, the economic impact, we think, is that depends on what the county finally moves out there. But we think more people, makes sense to me, more people downtown make a more vibrant downtown. I mean, it's not hard rocket science to understand the economics of that. More people downtown mean they will have more need for attendant and related businesses, whether they're eating establishments or other kinds of amenities that make a downtown vibrant. It also helps send to the business sector that are not here the importance of the importance of downtown as a major place to invest, right? So that's the opportunity, and some of the losses we think would happen. We don't think that the county, we think the county should be looking at opportunities, but we think the opportunities lie within the current government center complex as proposed.
Thank you. And a couple of, I think you've touched on these possibly. One question is, how is moving 147 county employees harmful to downtown Salinas? I think you actually just touched on that. Sort of a two-part question. Why do people say that it will, if the county does move to Schilling Place, that it will cost 2,000 jobs, of course, which aren't there, when the market shows no support of attracting an employer of that size to the Schilling site? And then kind of a part B of that question, why isn't the city looking at the county vacating leased facilities as an opportunity to attract new employers of the size more likely, far more likely to start up in the new economy? Okay.
So I think I touched on most of those issues in the previous comments. Again, we're sold on downtown as being the heart and soul of this city. We think that economically and otherwise. We spent a lot of money and resources in promoting a downtown renewal. We put our money where our mouth is. We've actually done that. We've secured the commitments by the county as well, and the city and other parties to make a vibrant downtown. It takes lots of different entities and lots of different organizations to really make this downtown work. Now, the actual loss of jobs might be initially minimal, but that could expand. We saw the chart on the wall there that said that there's also possibilities of further, consolidation that would occur at Schilling Place. I mean, that building was 200,000 square feet on the main building. That building is not going to be filled up with 147 employees, right? So there's more to come. There has to be more in the way of economics to make that lease or that acquisition work. It seems to us that the opportunity really here is on how you make the downtown more, I think, appealable in terms of the economics. If the signal is that the county is not interested in that, they're moving people away from the core, then the investment community will recognize that. And it means a harder sell for the private sector in the downtown, and it means a harder sell for the city downtown. So I think those are the main issues with us. We can certainly get into the economics, but we didn't have the specifics in terms of the numbers. The numbers we saw were the first numbers we've seen in terms of the proposition to moving to Capital One.
Thank you, Mr. Corpus. Mr. Young, did you have a...
Thank you, Madam Supervisor. One of the things I should have clarified earlier, we went through the slideshow fairly quickly, but the preliminary space planning for Schilling Place includes the location of other functions, not just the resource management agency, that are difficult to locate downtown in the most optimistic of circumstances, such as our record storage facility. I think I did mention that, but that's one of the key things that we could do. It's Schilling that it's unlikely we would ever be able to do downtown. We would also centralize information technology at the Schilling Place, and that's another function that would be very hard for us ever to centralize in downtown Salinas. The two other major functions that would move in are elections, which is hard to centralize in downtown Salinas, and the Water Resources Agency, which because of their equipment is also hard to locate in downtown Salinas. So the plan that we showed, the preliminary space occupancy plan that you can access through the link that I mentioned, is not, it is the plan for occupancy of that facility, and it's just under 400 employees altogether. So we don't think that in the long term there's a substantial, there will be a substantial move of additional county employees to that location. We think the 400 with IT, elections, records, water resources, and the resource management agency is pretty close to what that facility would be utilized even in the long term. What it does allow in the longer term is the opportunity to locate things such as some of our maintenance functions at that location, because there's quite a bit of vacant space there. And in fact, there's 3 acres that's completely undeveloped. And so there, to the point that I tried to make earlier, that we would retain downtown as the government center and our legal services center, the court center, there's simply not enough room, space, cost capacity and time to do some of those other functions downtown, in my view.
Thank you for that. Couple of questions. First, what happens to the negotiated price at Schilling if the county does not sign the agreement at the end of this month?
That'll go back on the market, I would imagine. I would have to defer to the seller in that regard. My presumption is that they would put it back on the market.
Great, thank you. Now, two questions. How much are you spending to move 130 people, 140, 400 people, whatever? What will you be doing with the rest of the space at Schilling? I think you may have touched on that. And then kind of a related question, why do 147 people need 1,175 parking places? Are there plans that would require nearly 2,000 parking spaces?
Appreciate the question, thank you. Let me reiterate, there'd be just under 400 employees at that location, not 147. The 147 is the number that would potentially move from downtown to that location. The others are coming in from already dispersed functions and facilities around Salinas. So it's information technology, elections, records, and water resources. When we first started to look at this facility, we honestly believed that it would accommodate quite a bit more than that. But as we did the preliminary space planning with our architectural firm, it became obvious to us to properly repurpose the facility and provide functions like elections with the elbow room that they need to run a proper elections function for all of the county. You can't put as many people into that facility as you might think. A call center is different with 800 or 900 employees in a call center. It's very compact cubicles, and if you were to enter the facility now, you would see that it's a sea of cubicles. But for proper county functioning and purposing for providing the kind of services that IT, elections, records, water resources, and the RMA represent, needs to be repurposed. And we estimated the cost of repurposing at $16 million. As I indicated earlier, I think that's a very conservative estimate, but that is the present estimate.
Thank you. Thank you. We're getting close to the end of the time we'd allocated. I have one more series that I think is fairly quick to get through. Will this project be considered a project under CEQA? Will you be studying environmental impacts? And what is your budget for studies and mitigation?
That's a very good question. Thank you. We don't think so, but we are looking at that also, Supervisor Parker. It appears that the city, when the facility was permitted, it was permitted in phases over maybe a 10-year period or something. And even though there were substantially more people operating out of that facility at the time it was operated as a call center, maybe 2 900 employee shifts, for example, at peak, and we would only be bringing in 400, we don't think there's a CEQA obligation that would fall upon the county related to occupancy of the facility with 400 people. We're still looking into that with our attorneys to make sure. And if it's necessary, then obviously we would comply with the state law in that regard.
Thank you. Thank you. Just a couple of cleanup. There were a couple of people asking who would move. And I think that's, I hope that's been answered. One question that is here that hasn't been touched on is, would a new hearing chambers be built into the structure to allow for required hearings? I assume that means other than Board of Supervisors meetings, but hearings related to the functions that are proposed for the building.
Thank you for that question too. Presently, we do not believe, and when I say we, that's, we're talking staff. Remember, we do staff work, we make recommendations and provide analysis to the board for decisions. We do not anticipate, staff anyway, that we would build a new hearing chambers at that location. We would have to have some remote capability for staff presentation so that we don't have to run back and forth to downtown necessarily on board meeting days. But we have not included the construction of a new hearing chambers in the preliminary estimation of the move-in costs.
Great, thank you. And then there was a question that the questioner seemed to have the impression that the DA and public defender might be moving to Schilling Place, and that would be create a lot of traffic going back and forth to the courts, and that is not in fact the case. The idea is to keep the district attorney and the public defender close to the court's buildings. I'm not sure we could persuade them, shall we say, to do anything different. So thank you for all the questions, and I will turn it over to the mayor to launch the public comment.
We're now going to go into public comment. Could I see a show of hands of folks that would like to talk? So I have an idea. All right, thank you. I'll start with Mr. Farmer from the chamber. Okay, if we'll have them go first, let's move them up right now and let's do this. I'll give each of them 5 minutes and then we will move on.
Was that two?
Two. Two.
And then 3 minutes for everybody else. Make sure
PowerPoint's two.
Let's step to it. Folks are waiting. Sorry to rush you, but we're ready to go, sir.
Good afternoon, Mr. Mayor, Supervisor Parker, City and County staff. My name is David Zender. I'm with Economic and Planning Systems, a managing principal out of Sacramento. EPS has advised municipalities, jurisdictions over the last 30 years, looking at public-private developments and strengthening of downtowns throughout the nation. And I just wanted to share some comments regarding this proposed move to Schilling Space. Also, I would just mention that I'm also very familiar with the county's economy, having done something on the order of 20 studies in the last 15 years here in Monterey County, and I worked on the economic development element for the city. Overall, I was quite taken aback when I first gained awareness of the proposed move of the county from the downtown to Schilling Place. We have four concerns that are highlighted in a 20-page memorandum that's been distributed, and you should have a copy of this document. There's also a one-page summary that sort of highlights the different findings, and that's shown here, and we can just scroll down as I go through the different findings. Overall, there are four major categories of impact that we see occurring as a result of this proposed move. The first is negative implications of public sector disinvestment on the prospects for new investment in downtown by the private sector. The second is the lost opportunity to generate private activity at Schilling Place. Third, public acquisition of the site will reduce property values significantly. And fourth, this has a major impact in terms of some of the initiatives that the city manager discussed in terms of strategic reinvestment and intensification of development in the downtown area. I'm just going to touch on these four very briefly. First of all, the city is really very well on its way to solidifying its downtown. It is making the approach, the plans and the strategies to basically make the turn in terms of taking downtown from what is now a very nice, very walkable district to a compelling district for private sector investment. Right now, we're coming out of a recession, and lease rates are increasing, but they're not quite where they used to be prior to the recession. If we see increased growth in lease rates, then we'll see increased private sector investment. Any kind of move that decentralizes the intensification, decentralizes the county's presence or any other public agency's presence in the downtown will have a material impact on the improvement of economic conditions in the area. We think it could increase lease rates for available space from 12% to 15%, and that's only assuming 30,000 square feet relocates. It certainly could be more, judging by the numbers we've heard today in terms of 149 employees. I might mention that San Jose presents a very good case study in terms of the impact that can be incurred when a public agency moves outside of a city center. This occurred in the 1950s in San Jose, and that was the beginning of a deterioration in conditions that was quite stark. And it wasn't until the 2000s that they made the public policy move to come back. And that stimulated a complete resurgence of downtown San Jose. And you can see the evidence if you ever go take a look. It's quite remarkable. Second of all, I think the Capital One site, in terms of generating private sector activity in the economic development element, we found a very distinct lack of shovel-ready parcels, and even more, a lack of ready-to-go space that could accommodate a variety of different industries. And we believe that this property could be subdivided. I don't necessarily see it as a Broderbund-type facility such as that in Scotts Valley, as was mentioned. I think it might be more easily subdivided than that owner-user designed property. And this is something that might lend itself to speculative development from a variety of different tech users and others. Overall, the private sector lost opportunity of taking possession by the county could be $195 million in industry output, something on the order of 2,000 to 2,500 jobs, and $82 million in employee compensation. Those are the numbers that would arise out of a private sector absorption of the Schilling Place site. Third, property tax collections will decrease significantly with the public acquisition of this. And the site generally currently generates $235 million in property taxes. The number annually, this number could go to $650 million annually with the intense. Excuse me, $652,000 annually, as market values recover. Currently, $235,000 could scale up to $652,000. Thank you. And then finally, it's really just very clear that public sector investments really do stimulate private sector investments, and people do look to the public sector to be leaders and to basically put their money where their mouth is when it comes to urban planning and urban intensification. And I can tell you from all of our experience around the country, it is a state of the art or state of the industry to really focus your investment as a public sector agency in your downtown. And you must lead by example, and without that kind of example, the private sector will not interpret the opportunity the same way, and they will lose faith in your downtown. We believe that it's very important to take on the type of master planning that the city manager discussed. It can be certainly an involved process, but empirical evidence suggests that it's well worth it. And you certainly have the circumstances here that are perfect in terms of realizing that kind of private sector investment. When you have something like Taylor Farms coming forward that has several floors of space that will be made available to the private sector, it's very important to do everything you can to intensify development, look for increased lease rates, and therefore better feasibility. So with that, we believe that it would be really wise to double down and recommit to the maximum public presence in downtown Salinas, and all of our experience and evidence suggests that that would be to Salinas' benefit. Thank you.
Thank you. Now we have a traffic person.
Transportation person, actually, not traffic. So my name's Jane Clayton. I'm from Hexagon Transportation Consultants. We're a multi-purpose transportation consulting firm. We have offices in San Jose and in Gilroy. We did not actually do a traffic impact analysis, such as Mr. Murdoch spoke of earlier, because we did not have enough data on the number of employees and the trip distribution that's required for a study of that nature. So I'm speaking to the basic question of what are the transportation, broader transportation implications of moving from the county offices from downtown to the CAP 1 site. There is a PowerPoint presentation on that computer that we loaded previously. The things that we looked at were transit, pedestrian and bicycle access, trip lengths, how many trips would be made, what is the impact on energy usage and greenhouse gas emissions, and what is the consistency or lack of it with transit-oriented development and sustainable community strategies, and what is the compatibility with the land uses out at the site right now. So there we are, and that's the slide that I just went through. So thank you. So right now, the first thing I want to discuss is public transit. Right now, downtown Salinas has absolutely fantastic public transit. The county offices are currently benefiting both in terms of employees who can travel to work by bus and in terms of members of the public, your clients or customers, that want to access the offices by bus. And we're not talking, oh, there might be one bus route or two bus routes. There are six bus routes right here on Alisal Street and right at the Salinas Transit Center, close walking distance, there are 18 routes. That is what in the transit world we call a very transit-rich environment. It means anyone from any part of the county or any part of Salinas that is served by MST can readily get to the county offices that are downtown. And probably without transferring, because downtown Salinas functions as the hub, whereas where the CAP 1 site is like the far end of what would be a spoke. So this is a really fantastic location. It's the kind of place that if you were going to say, well, where would we want to put county offices, you would say, oh, obviously in downtown, because that's where the bus service is. So not only is there fantastic service now, there's some really exciting plans to improve public access to public transit. The regional transportation plan by of TAMC, which is abbreviated here as RTP, has plans for intermodal transit center, which actually has already been spoken to, a multimodal corridor, bus rapid transit improvements in two different corridors within Salinas, and even more. That's a really large investment beyond what's already there, which is substantial, in public transit serving downtown. And it's important to note that there's this symbiotic relationship between the kind of service you want to have serving your downtown, the land use. The county is benefiting from the fact that workers and clients can now get to their offices on transit, but the transit MST's investment in service benefits from the fact that you've got a vibrant core, and you need that interrelationship between your land use decisions and the public transit agency. So if we contrast that with what's out there now at the Cap 1 site, right now there really isn't any bus service there. The closest bus service is Route 23, which runs down Abbott, and it's a half mile away, and not a particularly inviting walk to the bus stop. If you were to extend the route, though, to serve the county office, that's still only one route. And so that means that most of the people who would want to get to that county office still probably have to come from somewhere else, transfer to the bus that goes down to the county office. So even if you put one bus stop there and one route, it's nothing like the 18 routes that currently serve downtown Salinas. And the Route 23, which is the only logical extent thing that you could extend, only operates about once an hour. The other thing I would point out is that to extend Route 23 from Abbott over to the Cap 1 site on Schilling Place is not free. If you were really going to do a financial analysis of the proposed move, you would want to include the additional cost for bringing that bus over to the site and back. And I don't know the operating cost per hour or operating cost per mile of MST service, but adding that service to every run, every day, for a whole year is an additional cost if you were to actually put a bus stop there. If you weren't to put a bus stop there, then you're basically acknowledging that the county offices have no service. And neither one of those looks like a very attractive alternative. Bicycle access. The current site is not bicycle friendly. There's no bike paths or bike lanes leading to the site. There's multiple railroad crossings in the vicinity, which are a hazard, and the big truck traffic that runs through that neighborhood are not the kind of thing that bicyclists like to be riding right next to. So the site actually discourages access by bicycle. Actually, I was going to go back because I also had a slide on pedestrian access. All right. So there was a slide noting that, in fact, it's not a walkable neighborhood. No one's going to get there on foot. The proposed site is about 3 miles from the current the downtown location, and so there's going to be a lot more. The estimate, without knowing the exact numbers, there's longer trip lengths, basically. Not only that, there's going to be more trips, because some of the trips that are now being made by people who can walk downtown or combine trips with other things in downtown Salinas wouldn't be there. You've got to drive anywhere you would go from the proposed site. So you've got longer vehicle trips, you're going to have more vehicle trips, you're going to have fewer transit trips, you're going to have fewer pedestrian and bicycle trips, and all of that adds up to more greenhouse gas emissions, more pollution, and more energy usage. And those are all not where the county is wants to head. Those are significant environmental costs. And at this point, when I looked into the policy framework, it's clear AMBAG just in June 2014 adopted a new plan, a 2035 plan, which basically embraces a sustainable community strategy. TAMC has adopted a plan, and Monterey Salinas Transit all have plans which basically say, let's go for transit-oriented development and sustainable communities. If you look at the goal, the five major goal areas in the regional transportation plan, it isn't just that the proposed relocation is not supporting the environmental stewardship goal. It actually, all five goal areas are not supported by the proposed move, because they all speak to, let's get more people out of their cars, reduce emissions, have more trips by bicycle, more trips by pedestrians, and more trips by transit. So the economic development spoke to the positive feedback cycle. I won't go into detail on that. But the conclusion is that there are a lot of transportation-related benefits to have the current site, and that they just don't exist and won't exist at the Capital One site. Thank you.
Thank you.
Good afternoon. My name is Michael Harrington. I'm a local attorney with Brian Finnegan's office. I'll be brief. I know there are a lot of people here today, but I'd like to make a few comments. The majority of my comments are embodied in a letter that I'd like to submit on behalf of the Save Our Local Economy, and I'll introduce that tonight. Respectfully, I would like to disagree with the previous statements regarding the California Environmental Quality Act. I would argue that the acquisition of the Cap 1 site is subject to the California Environmental Quality Act and its informational requirements. I think a critical component of this project and the county's acquisition is that it potentially represents the first irrevocable step in a much larger program of relocation of county services. As such, I believe it meets the definition and constitutes a project under CEQA as a discretionary project approved by a public agency which may cause either a direct physical change in the environment or a reasonably foreseeable indirect physical change. Now, the direct change that you could talk about would be traffic, which was just highlighted. But the indirect physical change would be an economic one, and that was, you have before you the memorandum from EPS, and it touches on urban decay and blight. And I would argue that that urban decay stemming from increased office space vacancies due to relocation from the downtown area has the reasonably foreseeable potential to result in urban decay in the downtown area. An EIR is required under CEQA if there is substantial evidence that the project may have a significant effect. Now, a significant effect is defined as a potentially substantial adverse change on the physical environment. Statutory law and case law both are very clear that CEQA mandates that urban decay be addressed in an EIR when the economic effects of a project cause a physical change, and this physical change is to be regarded as a significant effect, even if it is an economic issue. And as a corollary to that, obviously, if there is an EIR that's required, you also have to talk about mitigation measures and analysis. So I'd just like to submit this letter, and maybe I can give that to you.
Thank you.
Sorry. Okay. My name is Bill Freeman. I'm opposed to Monterey County purchasing the building on Schilling's Place that used to be owned by Capital, that's still owned by Capital One. I believe that I'd like to see someone buy that, that can hire 850 people, that can support their families and send their children to college. I think that it doesn't make any sense to me that the county just wants to move a little over 400 people there. And if you want to ever revitalize Old Town and downtown, you got to keep businesses down there, got to keep employees down there. They're going to be buying lunch and be going to small businesses. You're going to ruin the small businesses down there, and that's what I think needs to be done. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Good afternoon. Thank you very much for having this meeting. My name is Maureen Ruck. I'm a small business owner right here in Salinas. I have 15 meetings. My staff and I have probably 15 to 18 meetings a week with the Planning and Development Department and the Building Department and RMA. Okay? That's 15 trips over to Schilling and back. When I walk now, I currently signed lease so I could walk back and forth to the Planning and Building Inspection Department. Okay, 5-year lease, so I could walk back and forth based on the fact that they were going to move over there and be there. So I signed a 5-year lease. I can't imagine what it's gonna be like for my staff and I to make all of these meetings over at Schilling Place without having to just chill our heels someplace for an hour for the next meeting. That's going to be very difficult. It's also going to be very, very difficult for us to drag 70 pounds of plans over to Schilling Place. They come off a printer now, they're put in a wagon, the wagon goes 2 blocks down to the department where they offload them. Now I'm going to have to schlep them into a car? I don't think so. Schlep them over there, schlep them into the building, or put the cart in the car, which isn't gonna work either. I just don't think that you are doing your constituents at planning, at building, at RMA, a very just, a justice here, okay? Furthermore, it is so clear to me that you have no idea what a permit center is, nor do you know what it takes to staff one. You don't have enough people in planning and building now. You would have to add water resources, the environmental health center, the fire department, and public works, all over in Schilling Place where you want a one-stop permit center. Oh, and we need the recorder's office and the assessor's office, by the way. So this one-stop permit center isn't going to happen. I know that, that's been promised before. So I really don't want second floor moving. I don't want anybody moving over to Schilling Place. Thank you.
Thank you.
Good evening, my name's John McPherson. I am a former employee of Capital One / HSBC / household. And just wanted to say a few words on behalf of all the former employees. When that facility shut down, it was very traumatic for this entire county, and it needs to be made very clear that that facility was not just a Salinas employer, it was a county employer. We had employees from South County, from North County, from the Peninsula, from Marina, from Seaside. It was a very dynamic employer for the county. And I also heard mentioned that it was a call center. There were quite a few call center jobs there, but there were also IT jobs and finance jobs and marketing jobs. It was a very, very dynamic employer. And a lot of those former employees had to leave the area, but most of them are still here. And most of them are still looking for work. And I think that is, to me, the most critical thing in this entire discussion is what do we do to bring a good private employer back into that facility so we can recover some of those jobs that were lost. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir.
Hello, good evening. Paul Farmer, CEO of the Chamber and one of the leaders of Save Our Local Economy. I want to first thank Supervisor Partner for convening this group and for listening and for being diligent, and also to Mayor Gunter and Mr. Corpus for all of the work they've done, and the city council members. I believe Jill Lutz and McShane are eating buttered popcorn next door listening to this. So thank you all for that. I just have a couple of points. Benny, I want to thank you very much for putting your due diligence online today as we requested, so we have a week to look at it. It's a lot of paper to chew through, but thank you very much for doing that. I also want to thank you, Benny, for your very honest response to one question, which is, what was the larger impact of the county doing this? And you said, we don't know. We did not have the time to spend the resources to look at that. You looked at it as a county business decision, but it's a very important county decision, and we think that we need to look at that. We need to look at how it affects the rest of the city, the property taxes, and all the rest of that stuff. So I think you gave a very honest answer, but I think that we need to have a better answer. And third, I just want to say that the coalition, SOL, is not just some business groups. It now includes Green Building Council, it includes COPA and the Center for Community Advocacy. There are a lot of groups that normally don't get together for this, but when we've talked to them about this idea, unanimously, people have said, we don't think that's the best idea. I know it may be expedient, it may be easier, and it may look cheaper to the county in the short term. But I think if we look at the longer term, it's not such a great deal. And I'll end on a positive note, which is that I got to travel back east this last week, and I went to Chicago, Cincinnati, and Columbus. And when I was biking around those downtowns and walking around those downtowns, I saw how the government buildings were an integral part of a vibrant downtown. And it makes me think of the positive, what we could do with the county helping to lead. And I hope that the county doesn't move forward with this. It'll be a harder route for us to build the government center, but I think it'll be the best one for generations. And thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Excuse me. Thank you for, again, holding this opportunity. Really appreciate it. My name is Larry Bussard. I'm the retired redevelopment director for the city of Salinas. In the last 30 years, the city has expended a great deal of time and dollars in an effort to turn downtown around. We had a lot of help from Supervisor Armenta and Supervisor Simone Salinas, who were on our city council at that point in time. Between 1984 and 2010, the city Salinas Redevelopment Agency spent $46 million on Old Town, $34 million on the 100 block acquisitions, which provided land for the National Steinbeck Center, Maya Cinema, and the Taylor Building. We spent $900,000 on unreinforced masonry buildings that were a result of the Loma Prieta earthquake in 1989. The seismic implications of what private developers had to endure as a result of Loma Prieta were significant. The $900,000 the city spent was a drop in the bucket. Frank Saunders alone, who owns three buildings on the intersection of Main and Gabilan, spent somewhere close to $750,000 on each of those buildings without a dime increase in rent. We also spent little projects like $400 million for the train station. We had another little project, just to give you a sense, of $85,000 that went into the theater for aerial theater. We spent $350,000 on facade grants. Again, that was about 5% of what the private property owners spent as a result of that. The total, between 1990 and 2010, is more than $70 million in private investment that occurred in downtown. In my professional, now retired, but professional opinion, the decision to go to Capital One would be 180 degrees in reverse of what we have all worked hard, so hard on over those last 30 years. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Thank you. Jim Riley, a partner in Rollick's Coffee in Old Town. It's been mentioned that a number of people will be removed from the courthouse to the Capital One Center, but they'll be replaced by the people from the Taylor Center. That's kind of a defeatist attitude. Why can't we have the people from the Taylor Center and keep the people from the courthouse? That would be progressive. Also, I live in Spreckles. I go to Highway 101 a lot. And I know that anytime after 2:30 or 3 in the afternoon, it's easier for me to go 68 Blanco Road, Davis Road, Laurel to 101 to go north than it is to try and battle the parking lot on Airport Boulevard that goes from Abbott Street to the freeway. And also, in 8 o'clock in the morning, if any of you have gone from the north going south on 101, anytime from 7:15 or 7:30 until approximately 9 o'clock, you're on the parking lot on US 101 for many, many stoplights to get off at Airport Boulevard. Granted, the new northbound exit has helped, But if you throw another 400 cars into that road, you're going to have a massive parking problem on the public streets, not parking, you know, congestion. So I bring that up, along with the fact that there is no transportation to speak of except that one bus line. So the 10 minutes it takes to get from Capital One to Old Town, I almost choked when I saw that, because I go from Harkins and Abbott and Spreckles to downtown every day, and I would love to be able to do it in 10 minutes on the best of days.
Thank you, sir. We have time for two more, and then we're going to have some closing comments.
Patricia Friedrich, and I say by the building. 7 o'clock at night, I went to the parking lot behind Off Street Mall, and my tire was slashed. The county offices are open from 8 to 5. That does nothing for your revitalization of downtown Salinas after 5 o'clock at night. I am the face of the county. I live in unincorporated lands. There is more than just the city of Salinas that is involved in this process. I want my money spent in the wisest fashion possible. What I saw today from the presentation was that was the wisest presentation of this stuff possible. I didn't hear anything from the city of Salinas about how fast this can go, when it's going to be done. The county needs to move now, and the city of Salinas wants the county out of those portables now. You have nowhere to put them now. The Capital One building is a place to put them now. I want my money spent in the wisest way possible, and that to me is it.
Thank you, ma'am.
Joel Panzer, resident of the city of Salinas and also business owner down here. I spend a lot of time downtown walking back and forth to the county courthouse and doing business, and it would just be very difficult to have to get in a car, drive over to the county. It's random you get over there. There's either no wait or you're sitting there for an hour, and I can always go back to my office and try again later. It just makes no sense. I'm hoping we'll get some leadership from Supervisor Parker and Mayor Gunter on this issue. I also am not speaking for Old Town Association, but I sit on that board, and I would tell you there's business owners and merchants down here that have made investment decisions, significant investment decisions, assuming we'll remain a county seat downtown and not take 150 employees and move them to South Salinas. So even though Mr. Young says we're not, you know, under this plan, you wouldn't abandon downtown, I say if you're taking those 150 people and putting them elsewhere, you are. Even though there's a commitment to downtown, that's a significant amount of dollars. I see a lot of county staffers walking back and forth for coffee. Contrary to the other speaker that just talked, I see a lot of those county employees coming downtown after work because they happen to be downtown. And our thought is with the Taylor Center and having that momentum of more people, it'll create less vacancies downtown. And my last point, I guess, would be if this plan goes through, I just worry about the blight of the old jail, the old courthouse, if there's not going to be any money to refurbish and reinvest in those properties. What's that going to do to the look of downtown Salinas? And I do agree with Mr. Harrington from Brian Finnegan's office on the CEQA impact. That really is a change of use from an ag or whatever the office building is to a public center. And listening to the traffic and some of the economics, I think that really does rise to the level of a project under CEQA that needs to be studied. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. One more, and then we're going to go to the comments from, well, they're going to have an arm wrestling contest here.
I'm John Phillips. I worked in that courthouse for about 35 years in one place or the other. And I guess my big thought is that the county should take some real time and analyze this, because this is a big decision. It has long-range ramifications. And we shouldn't just react to the circumstances and make mistakes that we made before. And I think most of you know, I was presiding judge when we were building the new courthouse. We were going to build a new courthouse, the parking facility. We were going to rehab everything. And the county made the decision to put the money in it, even though all the contractors who contracted with us and negotiated with us said, don't ever try to turn that building into a courthouse. And they did, and we end up spending $85, $90 million on that, and still don't have the parking. And so I think we have to take a look at it. And I also think, though, that the city and the county have to work together better. And maybe this is a process that can help do that. I know when we tried to do a parking facility before, there was the city opposed to it. And parking is a real, real problem for the public and for the people working there and for jurors. There's some real pros for this this Capital One. No one can deny that. $13 million for it is, and it would help the parking situation down here. But we're talking about putting $16 million in to rehab it. Then we're talking about a building that was designed for building and planning, then turning around and putting the district attorney in there. And some people in the district attorney's office say that one floor won't be enough. And we're talking about $4.1 million for that. And we still haven't dealt with the parking issue. And we still have to deal with something because the old building is a historic building. So we still have to deal with that. So with this 400-page document coming out, my only thought is the county, I would ask them to take some time and really analyze and study this. I'm sure you will. Thank you.
Thank you. We're now going to go to Supervisor Parker for her closing comments.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. And I want to thank everyone for being here and for the really thoughtful comments and questions. I do want to mention that if you didn't get a chance to speak and there's something that you want, or even if you did speak and you want something to be on the public record for our decision making, you would need to send an email or send a letter to the clerk of the board of the county, and that's COB. Clerk of Board, at co.monterey.ca.us. And I want to express my appreciation to the county staff for being here today and also for making the due diligence report available this week earlier than the legal requirement. Obviously, we need to give people time to sort through the information. And I know a lot of the calls that I've been getting expressing concern about this really have been based on things that are not quite accurate. So now that the information is out, now we can all, I think, be talking about the same issues. And it's a real challenge. I appreciate the opportunity to hear from the community because clearly there are arguments in favor of making this purchase. There are some concerns that might mitigate against that. And you know, at the county, we are close to and we partner with, we live with the city of Salinas, and we also have the entire county to think about. So our responsibilities really are to try to balance all of those interests and do it in a way that's responsible in the short term and in the long term. So I will be taking all of your comments into consideration as I look through the information and just really appreciate everyone for coming.
Thank you. I want to thank the supervisor. She's the one person that has agreed to come forth and talk to the public, and I certainly appreciate that, and to bring her staff. And I appreciate the city manager telling you what we've been doing. I think we've been all given a lot of information tonight. I am of the personal opinion, I don't want the county to move to Capital One. I don't think there's been any secret about that. Some people say I haven't stomped my feet enough, but I can see Supervisor Parker wouldn't be impressed by that. But I think I listened to the economics, I listened to the traffic problem, or the transportation problem, as the young lady said. But I also looked at the fact that environmentally, we're going to put some more cars on the road, that there'll be no buses. And I think that's something we all have to think about. I looked at the people in this room, we're not long for here, folks. So we've got to think about the people we're going to leave behind. And this may be an opportunity that we got to take care of. So y'all have to think about the children, and it's not just us. So I think that's something to think about as we sit here today. I didn't hear the county saying they were going to have a bunch of Priuses driving out there. I have a feeling they own a lot of trucks. So I think we need to work together on this, but I think we can work with them and we can keep them downtown. It would be good for everyone. So thank you for attending and have a good evening.